This is the Almost Timely newsletter for the week of March 31st, 2024. Content authenticity statement, 80% of this week's newsletter was generated by me, the human. You will see many outputs of generative AI in the opening section, including a PR pitch, some profiles, etc. There's a link at the top of the newsletter to learn why this kind of disclosure is important and a good idea and might be required for anyone doing business in any capacity with the EU in the near future. The EU AI Act is in the last stages of ratification. What's on my mind this week? Let's talk about step-by-step building an ideal customer profile from scratch with generative AI. Let's get down to brass tacks. We've talked a lot about, at a high level, about building an ideal customer profile, and the very best ideal customer profiles are built on a foundation of lots of high-quality data. That is still the gold standard, the way you want to do things if you can. In the past episode of this newsletter, I did walk through the basic process for that, a version of that on the Trust Insights podcast using CRM data. But let's acknowledge some realities. A lot of companies don't have that data. Right? They don't have the data either because their data is a mess. I fix that. Call me. Or because the company just doesn't have it. There's a reason why social networks have all locked down their data, canceled their APIs, or raised prices to make them unaffordable, and put up walls to interoperability as fast as possible. All these companies recognize just how valuable that data is. The good news is, you can still build a strong ideal customer profile with relatively little data. Now, it will not be as good as having lots of high-quality data, to be clear, right? It's not as good as having a well-maintained CRM and a well-maintained marketing automation system. But this will be good enough to at least start using generative AI more powerfully than, you know, the basic starter, you're a Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter prompts. Nothing wrong with those as starters. But an ideal customer profile gives you a lot more flexibility and a lot more power to invoke with generative AI. So for today's use case, I'm going to go back in time. I'm going to pretend I'm back at the public relations agency I used to work at. But this technique will work for just about any kind of role where you need an ideal customer profile, from sales to marketing to crisis communications to advertising up to job hunting, right? If you are trying to understand how someone else might react to your content, this technique will work for you. I'm just using it in a PR context because, like I said, I used to work in a PR agency, so I can speak firsthand. First, we need to be clear who is even in our ideal customer profile. Now, let's say I work at a B2B PR agency. I know that I need to get press coverage for my client. Let's say Trust Insights, my company, is the client. Trust Insights has a fancy new generative AI course, shameless plug, and wants to get the word out about it to journalists, right? We all know that this is going to be a terrible PR pitch, right? Because product pitches, unless you're Apple, no one cares. So we'll need a media list, or at least the start of a media list, of people who even cover the generative AI space. So our first stop will be any AI-enabled search engine like Microsoft Bing, Google Gemini, Perplexity AI. Any of those would be fine. Let's ask it with a prompt for a few names of prolific journalists in the generative AI space. My prompt is, who are the most prolific journalists covering the generative AI space in 2024, especially around generative AI and marketing? List your sources. And of course, it comes up with this nice summary. At the top of this list is author and influencer Bernard Marr. That's as good a place to start as any, right? So next, we should get a sense of what kinds of things Bernard writes about, right? So he says he's a Forbes contributor. Let's go and grab the last 20 articles that he's written. I was able to find 16 of them. Get them in plain text format. Now, you can automate this step or do it by hand, copying and pasting. Doesn't matter, as long as you end up with plain text articles when you're done. After that, let's grab the contents of Bernard's LinkedIn profile. The easiest way to do this is to simply download the PDF version of it. Almost every LinkedIn profile, if you are a first or second degree connection, there's a little thing under the More button that says Save to PDF. Right, download that PDF, and then using any PDF utility, convert it to text. So now you've got Bernard's dozen and a half articles and Bernard's LinkedIn profile. That's a good amount of raw materials to work with. So let's build a synthetic Bernard, right? So open the generative AI tool of your choice that can handle large data sets, like the paid versions of Google Gemini, ChatGPT, or Anthropic Claude. I can guarantee this technique does not work well with the free versions. You need to have a model that has a lot of short-term memory, and only the paid ones do for right now. So pick the one that you like best and drop your $20 on it, a month on it. Start your session by asking the model what it knows on the topic of building ideal customer profiles. Right? We want to prime the model. So my prompt was, today we're going to build an ideal customer profile. What do you know about best practices for this sort of thing? And of course, it spits out a whole bunch of stuff. Every model is going to behave differently, but this will give you a starting point for framing out that ICP. And more importantly, help the model give structure to all the data we're about to fling at it, because we're going to fling everything we just downloaded at the model. So once it's returned its answer, tell it you're going to give it some raw data to start inferring a profile, a persona. And my prompt was, great, thank you. I'm going to provide you with a large body of data of a person who is our ideal customer. This person, Bernard, represents the ideal customer from my company, Trust Insights. From this information and the best practices you've outlined, I'd like you to infer an ideal customer persona using the key elements you just highlighted and the information I provided from Bernard's publicly available information. Now, remember, I want to emphasize, this is a really important point. This is public information. It's out there in public, right? We are not using any proprietary data. We're not even using data out of paid tools. It's just search and copy pasting. The model will have itself a good long think, and it'll come up with a really nice profile of demographics, professional profile, occupation, industry, psychographics, behaviors, media consumption, values and challenges, motivations and goals, all that stuff that belongs in an ideal customer profile. You will want to read through this. You will want to edit it. You will want to tune it, right? This is what the model's inferred from the data we've provided, but it's pretty good. It's a pretty good start. It says things like, Bernard's a thought leader and influencer in the technology and business space, highly knowledgeable and passionate about emerging technologies, particularly AI and their impact on business and society. He is likely an early adopter of new technologies. He values data-driven decision-making, is a strong advocate for ethical and responsible use of AI, and so on and so forth. So this is a great start for this kind of persona. If the people I'm pitching for my PR agency are like Bernard, this persona is going to be super helpful, right? So what do we do with it? We put it to work. Suppose I have a pitch like this, right? Dear journalist, with generative tools, AI tools like ChatGPT booming, many marketers are... I can't even read this pitch. I mean, this is... I had generative AI come up with this pitch for our course, and I want to gag. Like, I get so many of these pitches. This is not a good pitch. It says, oh, this five-hour course has all these things, and could an interview with course creator Christopher Patton offer valuable insights to your audience navigating this rapidly changing landscape? Not a good pitch. And yet, I get hundreds of pitches like this every week. So how do we use our ideal customer profile, our synthetic Bernard? From the profile we generated, we ask him. I say, hey, you're going to role play Bernard. Here's a pitch. Critique it as Bernard. And Gemini says, let's channel Bernard and analyze his pitch. Here's how I imagine Bernard might react. Intrigued but cautious, a bit skeptical, appreciates connection, questions about depth, not sure about the target audience, etc. In other words, synthetic Bernard has basically said, pass, right? Which I would too. If I got this pitch, I would pass on it. As someone who receives a lot of pitches like this, I can say that Gemini's predicted reaction is actually much kinder than what runs through my mind when we read pitches this terrible. So now that we know our pitch isn't going to land, what do we do about it? I will leave the rest of the exercise for you to complete, but it's not a great leap of imagination for you to have an ongoing conversation with synthetic Bernard to say, how would you fix this pitch? What would you do differently? Pretend you're Bernard. What things are missing from my pitch? How should I reword it to be as appealing to you as possible? Right? The key takeaways from this exercise are that ideal customer profiles can be built with minimal data, and in this case, publicly available data. I had the contents of a LinkedIn profile plus 16 articles from the web. That's it. No multi-year sales data, no deep dive into a person's background, no secret agent stuff, no private information, just a pile of data from publicly available sources. And the persona generated was pretty good. It was pretty good. If you were doing this for your PR agency, for your marketing agency, for your sales team inside your company, for your corporate communications team trying to anticipate crises, you would want to broaden this beyond just a single person. Maybe you'd have 5 or 10 people's publicly available data as a starting point and create a roll-up synthetic persona or ideal customer profile from that data, right? If you're doing account-based marketing, maybe you have 5 LinkedIn profiles of 5 people who are on your key account list, and they go right in. If you're a job seeker, this technique applies to you. Synthesize a persona from the hiring managers that you've worked with, especially the ones that rejected you. And then use this persona, use the persona you create to critique your materials, right? Say, hey, you know, you're going to be the hiring manager, the synthetic hiring manager that rejected me. Why? Read my cover letter. What didn't I get right? Read my, we had an interview. The interview went badly. You asked me these questions. Here are my answers. Why was this a bad answer? Right? These tools are incredible for synthetically imitating real people, right? No matter what route you take, building an ideal customer profile is within reach for any organization, big or small, wealthy or poor, and any individual. Leverage the data you do have access to, plus the best models available to you today, and you can get started making use of generative AI with ideal customer profiles to answer questions you have about your marketing or really anything you want to ask it, right? All right, what else happened this week? I did a piece this week on how to use generative AI to head off criticisms. We created a persona called Thomas the Skeptic, and there's a long prompt. If you click through, the article actually has a copy of the prompt if you want to use it. But you basically use Thomas to critique your content. Say, hey, Thomas, beat me up, right? Tell me what I did wrong in this article, and it will. But it will make your writing stronger, your argument stronger, anything where you want to anticipate criticism. You want to almost go to the worst case scenario and say, oh, you know, what's my boss going to say about this? It's a technique for helping out with that. We also talked about why roles work in generative AI prompts, telling something, you know, it's an award-winning journalist or whatever. So there's some useful stuff on that. Also did a fun episode of the live stream this week on identifying use cases for generative AI at agencies. So if you work at an agency, check out that episode. It was a lot of fun. What else we got? Jobs this week. Let's see, we have digital marketing analyst at Dayforce, digital strategy director at Mod Intellecki. Okay. Director of growth marketing at Primarily Pure, director of marketing at Jove, director of search marketing at Geekly Media, marketing director at Frictionless, senior product manager at Etsy, VP of marketing at Ultimus Fund Solutions. Ultimus sounds like a Transformer name. Vice President of Marketing at Serve Recruitment Agency, VP of Marketing at Aspiron, VP of Marketing at Jobot, and VP of Digital and Growth at Diff Eyewear. So some cool stuff there. Upcoming events. This week, I am headed out to Nashville for Lab Products Association. We're keynoting their event. We're going to have a lot of fun talking about generative AI and then use cases specific to that industry. At the end of the month, I'm headed into the city for the Society for Marketing Professional Services, then doing the Australian Food and Grocery Council in Melbourne a couple weeks after that, and then back to LA for the Society for Marketing Professional Services for a 2-day workshop there, then the Marketing AI Conference in Cleveland in September, and the Marketing Prowess B2B Forum in Boston actually it's November this year. That one, I'm going to be doing a workshop with my partner and CEO, Katie. We're going to be doing the data-driven customer journey, how to build it and work with it using generative AI. Huge surprise. And I'm also doing a session called The B2B Marketer's Guide to Prompt Engineering. So you'll want to check that one out as well. That's going to do it for this week. Thank you, as always, for being here, for tuning in. And I look forward to hearing how the rest of that example with Synthetic Bernard went. And apologies to the real Bernard Marr if this was misrepresenting the data that I found. This is what Google's Gemini did with it. But hopefully it did a credible job of what the real Bernard Marr would have to say. Thanks for tuning in. We'll talk to you next time. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And if you want to know when new videos are available, hit the bell button to be notified as soon as new content is live.